Good morning. We are glad that you were with us on this June 13th morning. We hope that you are blessed by our gathering here in this place. We look forward to in the fall, as we approach October, to be together in this place. But for now, we thought at the very beginning it would be about 8 weeks that we would need to go on media. Now it's been close to a year and a half, and that's the way it is, and we've done the best we can. And we are so glad that you are there. In an audience that has become increasingly larger because of media. We're glad that you're here. Hope that you're blessed in some way as we continue to look at the 23rd Psalm. Hopefully we can hear it again for the first time. What works when life doesn't? And we're talking about guidance through dark valleys. So before we receive that message, let us gather about the piano along with Larry Loeber and be blessed by his marvelous music.
Pastor Dick and I are preaching through the 23rd Psalm, so you'll hear the 23rd Psalm for the next couple of weeks. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long.
Remember today that Psalm 23 are words of a forgiven man who had a lot that needed forgiving. Is that why the psalm speaks directly to our hearts? Because we are people who struggle with what we are sorry for, and we are always looking for a way that we can find healing in the midst of all of those things that we've done that are wrong. The psalm has attached David, a psalm of David. He's a man who needed forgiveness as much or more than any of the biblical characters. Guilty of murder and adultery, both punishable by death by sundown in his culture. And of course, he was forgiven. And it's in that light that this psalm is ascribed to him. A psychologist said, 90% of what I deal with, hear this clearly, And think about yourself. 90% of what I deal with could be cleared up if my clients would forgive others and know that they are forgiven. A therapist, 90%. Today we look at verses 3 and 4 of the 23rd Psalm. He leads me in right paths for His name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for You are with me. Your rod and Your staff, they comfort me. I'm going to look at three things in these two verses. First of all, let's look at the paths. He leads me in right paths for His name's sake. I remember my friend Bill McNabb, who was delivering an ambulance to some people in a very, very remote place in South Africa. They had to actually drive 1,200 miles with that ambulance to deliver it to a village. And somebody was trying to give them some directions. And part of the instructions were, watch out for the ruts that are there. There are ruts in the mud that come from the rainy season. And if you get in them, you're not going to be able to get out of them for a long period of time. The rut, he says, turned out to be a track. The key was to find one that fit our car. Whether a path is a rut or a track depends upon your choice and your perspective. In Tennessee, there's a country road where the same kind of situation existed. And after the rainy season, you got these deep ruts. And so they had a sign up there that said, choose your rut carefully because you're going to be in it for a long time. Now the Hebrew word here, path, means to roll something that is round, to roll something. It refers to entrenchment or a wagon track. It can be used negatively or positively. A negative path is the evil of which Jesus talked about. He prays for us to be delivered from it. It's a rut that we get into that creates all kinds of negative things. What are they for our time? Peer pressure in teen years? Intentional ill will. The positive path are paths that are right, the right paths. I visited the ruins of Pompeii. Fascinating, interesting. The ash came down and froze so many things exactly where they were that as they chipped away everything and uncovered it, they found some things to be very well preserved by that covering. The eruption came in 79 AD, and I can remember going down this one street, and the cart tracks were in the stone. They had been rolled across that stone so many times that here were these clear ruts, which was a path, a positive thing, in that particular culture. So the point is this, paths can be ruts or tracks, depending on how you look at them. I remember I was told I was in a rut one time. On Christmas Eve, there was a man who came to my church in Ohio. Many people would come out that night. You'd see four times as many people at any time of year. And so the guy came to the door one year, and I kind of remember him being down there in front, see him every Christmas Eve. That's the only time I'd see him. And he says, you know, Reverend, I think you're in a rut. Every time I come to this church, you talk about the birth of Jesus. I told this man, once a year is not enough to know about Jesus unless you're talking about your physical. Once a year is enough for that. Remember, whether a path is a rut or a track depends upon your perspective. Most of the time, we leave the parameters of the path not by choice, but by drifting. Think about that. He talks about right paths, the right thing to do. Most of the time we know the right thing to do, and we're with the Apostle Paul, says the very thing that I know I ought to do, I don't do, and the thing I should not do, I find myself doing it. I go, thank you, Paul, for speaking on behalf of all of us. We all get into that. We drift. We drift off into some things that can cause great danger for us and for other people. Drug addiction is like that. Well, you know, I just wanted to inhale a couple times. Well, then this guy went and brought something to the party, and now I'm stuck on heroin, and I'm in deep trouble. And I'm glad you came to visit me, Dick. And so we bless them. You know, sheep, they get lost because they nibble their way into lostness. They don't stand there and decide suddenly, you know, why don't we go and check out what's over the hill here? They just kind of nibble themselves into total lostness. And then the existential moment, where in the heck am I? I don't know if you remember the name of John Walker Lynch. He was a guy that grew up in a very nice family in Northern California. And in high school, he decided he wanted wanted to get a better understanding of God. And so he goes overseas, and he did not intend at that time to get involved with the Taliban. But do you remember? He got on over there, and some people taught him about God and talked about a very hateful God. And so he goes on a search for God, and got into the wrong path, and eventually landed a gun in his hands. And in his hands, he joined with Al-Qaeda. And finally, he found himself in jail. He didn't start that way. He went on a search, he said, for God. And then he nibbled his way from the right path. Jim Jones, it's hard for you to understand this, in the state of Indiana, he had the most incredible ministry of having white folk and black folk all together in one place. Now, most of our churches pay close attention to that because Martin Luther King said in the 60s, and it's true today, the most segregated hour in America is 11 o'clock on Sunday morning. But Jim Jones had conquered that. And then he came out to California. And then he had two different groups there. And then all of a sudden, he took a bunch of people and went down to Guyana. He was a part of my denomination, the one I grew up in. And he gave a lot of money to the denomination, so they didn't ask any questions about the very quiet and very secretive meetings that he would have with his church. And then they're down in Guyana. And just as the denomination started to ask questions about what's this guy up to, on Sunday morning, I was informed that 800 of our people a part of my denomination, were dead. They didn't start that way. They nibbled their way from the right path. And before we get too self-righteous in the shadow of these extreme examples, let us remember, all we like sheep have gone astray. One of the texts for the Messiah, all we like sheep have gone astray. The point here is this, a path can be a rut or a track depending on your perspective. And then we look at the second part here. He talks about the shadows, though I walk through the valley of the shadow. What dark valleys in the future do you fear? What ones are bugging you right now? Fearful, keeping nervous, awake at 3 a.m. I remember walking into a facility with heavily locked doors exclusively for Alzheimer's patients. I had to call in advance. They had to have somebody come to the door, and they let me in. I was going to see the mother of a minister buddy of mine who was there, not doing well. And as I walked down the hallway, lots of voices screaming and one woman reaching out and grabbing at me, and I did the best I could to touch her gently. and to keep on going. And then the person ahead of me had to keep us moving ahead to go to the room I was looking for. It was a very painful sight, and always is. Every convalescent home in America makes many a clergy say, upon leaving, I don't want to end up here. Or what am I talking about? Every family member. I don't want to end up here. Some of us buy 3-year extended care insurance policies, hoping to God that we will never, ever have to use them. We know that it would be indeed like the ultimate valley of the shadow. People grabbing at me, cruel vestige of the life that is already gone while the body keeps running. I remember my mother-in-law, just before her passing, going to Iowa on Thanksgiving. We went to see her there. It would be her last Thanksgiving. And we went to see her, and there was nothing there, no response. What dark valleys scare me? I think only that one. If you want to get me off to the side and say what could scare you, that'd probably be the one. I went to see Vicky. I mentioned her one time in another sermon. And she was the one who looked at me one day and said, waiting is hard for you, isn't it? She says, you know what I'm waiting for. She smiled. And 2 days later, she went from this world to another shore. I was walking through the valley of the shadow with her. And I hope that we loved her enough in those last moments as she sailed off to a whole new beginning and a new life. She was standing in the shadow of her own death. Do you remember the one who said, be kind to each other? Because all of us are walking through some kind of shadow in life. Houston Smith, that man who wrote about world religions, visited my church one time, a marvelous man. And he was the one that had an overview. He lived all of the traditions. He didn't study them, he lived them. And he turned around to his own background in Christianity, and he said this. He said, Christianity offers the solution to the two greatest thieves of human happiness, guilt and fear. Grace cures guilt, and the promise of resurrection cures fear. The Lord is my shepherd, when rightly heard, cures both guilt and fear. And then the final thing here says that you are with me. You are with me. The common, the companion God never leaves us without the things we most need, which is God's own self. It was Roberta Bondi, a great, great scholar, who said, God doesn't deliver us from the fires of life, doesn't give us 5 more years of life, doesn't restore our brain to the way it was when we were 18 years of age. God doesn't stop the tree from killing my beautiful niece, whom we miss to this day. It doesn't change the makeup of my son's Down syndrome. In all of this, I will be with you. And that presence of God in our lives, in the life fires that we live, makes all the difference. I remember I mentioned my buddy Bill McNabb. There was one time that two churches wanted him to come and have him as their pastor, one in Northern California and one in Southern California. He was in Florida at the time, and Bill just kept talking to me. I don't know which one to do. I don't know which one to do. I just don't know what to do. And Bill said in the middle of the night one time, he said, God, where do you want me to go? And he said, I got an answer of some kind. God doesn't care where you are. God cares what you are. And I mentioned his trip into Africa there. There was, as he was choosing the ruts to deliver that ambulance, there was a man standing by the road looking at his map. And the guy was trying to explain what to watch out for 1,200 miles. And then the guy looked up at Bill with this puzzled look on his face, knowing he didn't have the faintest idea of what he was doing. And the guy folded up the map and said, "Forget it, I'll just go with you." Like that man, God does not promise to take us away from anything in this life, but promises to go with us through everything. Walter Brueggemann said, "It is God's companionship that transforms every situation." You know, the Apostles' Creed isn't really a favorite thing of mine. Matter of fact, I don't repeat it, nor do we in our church. But it talks about he descended into hell. Well, yes, you can say that. God descends into every hell with you on this earth. I'm here to tell you there is no hell you go through that God is not there. Down through every fear you have lived, down through the fear of a convalescent home, God descends into our hells and everything sickening as an oil spill on virgin sands. God descends into the very place where children struggle for life in a hospital or a rural village in Africa. To all of this, God reminds me, "Dick, I'm with you. I am with you." I can carry some of you back to the 1960s with Eldridge Cleaver, who was put in jail and he wrote a book, Soul on Ice. A fugitive that then took off to France to live there. He was in a deep depression there. And one night he cried. The only thing he remembered out of his childhood going to church was the Lord's Prayer and the 23rd Psalm. When he wrote Soul on Ice, the valley of the shadow was then the last word. Then later on, he wrote a book called Soul on Fire when he discovered that death is not a wall, but a door that leads to the presence of the one who has been with us all along. Thomas Merton said, and he's actually standing in the place of God when he says these words. He said, "The words of God for us are these. I disappear from the world as an object of interest in order to be everywhere in it by hiddenness and by companionship and by compassion." Do you remember at Christmas time? Normally it's on Christmas Eve. The same word, like that man said, same word on Christmas Eve, is the same as in the psalm. It was spoken by an angel. "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy." At the coming of Jesus, we have no fear. And on the day he leads us home, we have no fear. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. Amen.
Will you pray with me? Eternal God, you are so mysterious yet present among us now. And for both of those realities, we thank you. We thank you for your hidden prodding toward new discoveries. Be with us on our journey and lead us as the disciples we were led to embrace new and exciting ways of being the church in this exciting and scary time in which we live. We remember now all those whose names we have carried with us to this service. We know from the mouth of Jesus that you know in advance what we need, and we trust that to be true. We pray for all people in harm's way, soldiers and those they seek to help. We pray for new civility among Democrats, Republicans, Independents, and all people everywhere, knowing that the problems we face demand a new sense of oneness and cooperation. We give thanks for all who are given positions of leadership. We pray for our congregation as we plow new ground of love and service in the days ahead. So, eternal God, lead us in those times of stagnation when we feel nothing is happening and when we seem to be stuck in place. Lead us in those times when discouragement seems to overwhelm us and we think the quest for keeping on is futile. Lead us in those times when a new idea threatens some of our long-held beliefs and we become fearful. Lead us ever onward with the confidence that you have more light and truth to reveal to us from your word whenever we gather in your name. For we dare to pray all these things in the name of the one who taught disciples, and so we pray the same, saying, Our Father who is in heaven, holy be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Amen.
Let us go from this place, people, and be kind to each other, because everyone you meet this week is carrying something heavy and they need your kind encouragement. Go from this place. Welcome strangers into your life. You and I came as strangers into this life and we were welcomed and it made all the difference. Go from this place in perfect peace, knowing that after every word has been spoken, it will be the Good Shepherd who is always with you, who will guide you on beyond this world. May the peace of God be with you, we pray, now and always. Amen.